Hey, Renee, Chris, and Ryan going live. Best podcast, Beauty and the Bees. Sit back and catch a vibe.
Let's bring in our moderators today from Beauty and the Bees. Come on, bring them in. See, your welcome song is it's R&B today. That's my stick today. What's up, Renee? I haven't seen you on the stage this morning, so welcome.
Well, hopefully this one will go off without a hitch. Thank you, everybody, for coming back and not just walking away.
Yeah, you get through the entirety. Chris is wearing the shirt today that thumbs it up.
Well, we had a great time last night, and these that are with us today are not going to disappoint because they did not disappoint last night either. So you know them from The Walking Dead as Max, Sebastian, and Lance. Please welcome Margot, Teo, and John. Margo, there's a mic for you. There's a mic for you, Margo, right there near you. There you go. Yeah. Look at that. I got you, girl.
She was making sure you were paying attention.
That's right. I was quizzing you.
I thought it was just part of the acting. That was
totally.
Here she comes.
Welcome, guys.
Hey.
Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, happy to be here.
Yeah, how was your fire alarm experience?
It was cute.
Sorry about that. I just wanted some fresh air.
Yeah. Line was getting too long. He's like, people, come on.
Yeah. I thought Teo was about to say, wait, there was a fire alarm?
That was precisely what I was
about. I picked up on it. Yeah.
I really did it for the photo op with the fire alarm.
Yeah.
I try to take advantage of that whenever I
can. Yeah. Absolutely. So, what we got to talk about today, Ryan?
Well,
because I thought maybe you were ready. If not, I'm ready.
Renee's always ready. Renee is our deep dive researcher.
Well, hold on. Can I share a real quick funny story?
Oh, absolutely.
So, Chris, the firefighters were here. Margo was.
Are you going to throw me? All right. Like, we didn't even get started yet.
Throw me under the bus.
Oh, keep going.
Margo, at this point, you're a friend of ours. She's
happy. I was at the door over in their area. She goes, hey, guys, we're going to go take. No, she goes, hey, there's heroes. We're going to do a picture of some of heroes. I just hear heroes, so I come running out the door, and I'm like, where's the food?
He was the first one out.
We got heroes? She's like, no.
Last one out when the alarm went off, the first one out when I said heroes.
She's like, the firefighters? Those heroes.
They are yummy.
New York, a hero is food. No, I'm sorry.
I mean, you had your priorities straight, I guess.
I did. I gotta stay fueled.
So, it's been a while since you were here. Well, we didn't talk to you in October. We talked to you guys in October.
Yeah.
So we had a little lapse here. So, what's been going on? We'll start with you since it's been a little longer since we talked to you.
I don't know if everybody knows, but there's a strike going on right now. And we are all standing in solidarity with each other and making sure that we are making sure that our writers are having good pay after all of their hard work, and same with directors and same with actors, and it's a messy time. So not much is moving right now. But before the strike, I was lucky enough to have a job with the sequel of one of the Yellowstone productions for 1871. So that will come out in the winter.
Yay.
Very cool. That's
very
my jam.
Exciting. Yeah.
That's Chris's very
jam. Yeah, Chris and I are big Yellowstone anything. Well, nice. Taylor Sheridan, whatever fans.
Yeah. Taylor Sheridan universe. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah.
Can't wait to see.
Yeah, it'll be cool. Yeah.
So, since, you know, like, we didn't talk to you in October, but we did talk to you guys, and for all three of you guys, since we talked to you guys in October, the finale aired. So now we can kind of really talk about your feelings on how the show ended and things like that. So, you know, how do you guys feel about how the show ended? And do you think that if you were the writers, do you think that you would have taken the show in that direction, or would you have taken a different direction?
Who wants to start?
Dang.
It's a very low stakes question. I feel like that's
we happy for you guys, yeah, absolutely.
You know, I mean, there were so many plates spinning in the air for those writers, you know, so many storylines to cover, and I'm sort of in awe that they brought it all, you know, together like they did. And for me, I was truly just happy to get to be a zombie, to come back.
Yes.
So I was just grateful about that.
Absolutely.
I was so happy to see him at that gate. I was like, yes.
That's still one of my favorite photos of you at your table. Yeah. When I was walking by and I was talking to Becky from the camp, and I saw the picture of you as a zombie, and I'm like, oh, that's awesome.
Josh, he has behind the scenes photos.
Yeah, he does.
That he took himself.
Yes, I do.
Josh,
they're amazing.
He's an amazing photographer.
Incredible.
If y'all haven't seen his Instagram, please run.
I was just gonna say that.
Such a good photographer.
And make sure you do go to his table and check out the photos that he did take, because they are awesome. I picked up two of them myself and got them signed by the actors that they're of.
Until last year, I've always liked taking pictures, but I never really showed them around until I joined Instagram, and I don't love posting pictures of, like, me, you know, eating salad or whatever. And so,
okay, shots fired, I get it.
Take him sitting right next to you, I mean, come on.
No, I just mean, like, I haven't mastered the art of the selfie, so I was like, oh, I'll post pictures of other people, and then people seem to like them, so I printed out some, and I'm selling them here. You know, it's not too weird, right?
So I thought it was weird, but
I think it's very artistic.
Josh, very cool.
So what about you, Tay? What did you do the end?
I actually really liked it. Leading up to it, I was saying to everybody that ending a show, no matter how many seasons, even 2-3 seasons, it feels a lot like trying to land a plane. It is a very, very hard task. And then you take a show like this that has been on for 12 years, 11 seasons, I think that's exceedingly hard. And we've seen from huge saga shows, both positives and negatives. I think Breaking Bad is a perfect example of an amazing ending. Mm-hmm. I don't want to name names on any shows that aren't. I'll just say something that rhymes with, like, Shmame Shmones.
Yeah.
Sometimes wasn't my favorite cup of tea. And I do think that this actually did an amazing job at trying to navigate that line, especially knowing that there are so many spin-offs too.
Yeah.
So to say goodbye to characters, but also know that we're seeing them off.
Yeah.
I think it's a very difficult task.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we talked about that on our podcast because it's not like the universe is ending, right? Yeah. If the universe was ending and that was it, you can close every door possible, and you can kill off any character you want, you can give them any ending you want, but like Teo said, it's like landing a plane because the Walking Dead universe is continuing. There are shows, there are so many things that are happening that they have to leave the door open to because they just can't close that door, because once you ring that bell, you can't unring it. If you close that door, guess what? That person's gone. You can't do anything with them if you get rid of them.
So no, and also, I remember thinking like, oh, they should kill off more people to make it all more dramatic. No. And then I had, and then I watched the finale in the big theater, and you realize, oh no, it would have been too much to lose more than one major beloved character.
Yeah.
It would have been like just too, would have been like cake on cake, which is like you couldn't go through that emotionally, like for more than one, you know, or two, or three, you know, it's like it would be too much. So it wasn't just about keeping Mark alive for the thing. I think it actually just dramatically, like narratively, it would have been just overwhelming if it was just like 5 or 6 people. Gone.
Yeah, and for me, I know a lot of people are, you know, like afterwards people would complain that Luke, you know, we didn't see him and this and that, but man, that death and that was brutal.
Yeah, it was.
Holy buckets, that was brutal. We talked to Dan yesterday about it too. We were talking about just, you know, that whole group and how amazing that scene was. That was just, you know, regardless how much we had seen Luke or, you know, whatever, you hadn't been around yet. That was intense.
That was hard, yeah.
Right, it wasn't just one person, but it was, even that was like, no more.
if it was too much, it would have taken away from the emotional impact of other deaths.
Exactly.
Especially, you know, Christian Serrano's,
hers
was so emotional.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it was so heartfelt, and just everything that she went through with everyone else and saying her goodbyes.
Yeah,
it would have taken away from that.
Yeah, it was so well done. And what did you think about it?
I love the transition of power, kind of, you know, allowing the kids of the tomorrow to take over and next up. I can't wait to see where that goes.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Because right now we have like the spin-offs happening with our current characters, but with the kids, we have no idea where they're going to be, who they're going to become, who they're going to take after. You know, they could have been influenced by so many people, and they could meet people along the way. They could fall in love with really bad people. So, I mean, I just think that there's like a whole other wave of this that we just haven't even like scratched the surface of. That I'm most excited about.
Absolutely.
They'll be inspired by Uncle Lance. You know, I think that's
pillar of society there that they can look up to.
Oh boy.
I know, Josh, you've been in several new things recently. I don't know if you guys watched Accused. Have you seen the episode Josh was in? Have you heard of that series? Yeah. Holy buckets. If you've not watched Accused, the whole season is amazing. And there's several Walking Dead actors. And which episode number were you in? Do you remember? I forget now.
It was like the one before the last one.
Yeah, that's
point, maybe 14.
Yeah, somewhere in there. But anyway, the episode he was in was phenomenal. But check it out. It was a very, it's kind of a, you know, it's individual episode. Each episode is an anthology episode kind of thing. And yeah, but anyway, it was phenomenal. I just loved it. And then you were in the last thing he told me with Jennifer.
Oh yeah, that just finished.
Yeah, yeah. You're in several.
I was in like the last three episodes. Yeah, so yeah. Out of eight maybe.
Yeah. And then you got Reality coming tomorrow.
Yeah, that's the thing I talk about, because that's a movie that was based on it's a long story, but it was based on a transcript of the FBI interrogating Reality Winner, who was a whistleblower back in 2016, and she got the longest sentence of anyone who's ever shared classified information, even like longer than spies or sold things to, you know, for like lots of money. It was so this movie is the actual transcript of the FBI interrogating her. And I think it turned out really well. And it was like, we shot it last year as a low budget indie, and then HBO liked it and bought it. So now it seems like all fancy because it's an HBO, but like it was just a small movie there.
And
so
did you play one of the FBI?
Yeah, it's really just like basically a three character movie. So mm-hmm. It's Sydney Sweeney plays Reality Winner, and then there's two FBI guys who were talking to her.
So check that out. But the trailer looks really good. Yeah, I'm excited for that.
People seem to really like it.
Yeah, and then what, on IMDb, it says something about Tonight at Noon. Is that something?
That's one of the most weird IMDb things. That's like a movie we shot like 12 years ago and it never came out.
I don't know how you get it, because I talked to other actors who are like, yeah, that thing was like forever. I don't think it's going anywhere. Yeah, it just sticks there. So, yeah, okay, so that's all right. And then, Teo, you were in Fantasy Island not too long ago.
I was.
Yeah. Did you guys see that episode?
A sweet trip to Puerto Rico. That was a blast. I just did, I feel like off the bucket list, a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
So I would assume that will come out next.
For who? Like Hallmark?
No. Well, so it's one of these ones where it's like Indians are trying to push it to like Hallmark and Netflix and all that
stuff.
What
a dream. That's like every Jew's dream.
Oh, it is.
We want to be in a Christmas movie so badly.
We have all the good Christmas songs.
Yeah. Every Hanukkah song sucks.
Oh yeah, we don't do service.
There's no, I mean, like, what are you gonna sing, like, you know, blue and white, blue?
No.
Just doesn't sound the same.
It doesn't work.
What's the name of that?
So it's Holly Jolly. Okay. I know.
That's fantastic.
Slightly different than Sebastian. So that was definitely a fun change to your face.
It'd be a fun twist if you did play a Sebastian.
A very Scrooge. A very Milton Christmas. Yeah. I'll pitch that one to Angela.
That's exactly.
If they want to do a holiday special.
Work that one up for us.
Sebastian, get your own presents. Please.
All I want for Christmas this year is...
Honey, I don't care. Get the door for me.
Sebastian survives Christmas.
Sounds like a Tales episode.
Right? Yeah, you speak a little Tales episode.
Everybody start spamming in.
Everybody send that to her. You want to see that. And then, I don't know what this is. IMDb too, so maybe not, I don't know, but
that Bear
Me When I'm Dead?
Yes, a very similar kind of thing where I shot that a while ago.
Yeah.
Your guess will be as good as mine, and that sees the light of day. Yeah. But yeah, it was one of those like random ones where it was similarly just indie, you never know. So we'll see.
Yeah, okay, good. I just love to know these things,
Of course.
And then your neuro, I can't
say that. You're all good, neurodivergence.
That's the one, yeah. So tell us about that.
Yeah, so full disclosure, I'm very proud and excited to talk about this, but I am super dyslexic. Definitely would have been at the Derek Zoolander School for kids who can't read good, but are good at other stuff. Recently have been just doing a lot more advocacy work. I was speaking in some public schools with kids who are just, you know, very much at the beginning of that challenge. And that's what it is. I mean, especially because for a lot of kids, you get diagnosed when you're 5, 6, 7. And you deal with one of the hardest things you're gonna deal with in your life right off the bat. And have gotten really close with this casting director who's been doing a lot of work to try to figure out how to help influence the industry for kids, especially child actors who want to get into this, who might, you know, just learn differently, and just what are those kind of tools or techniques that we as the industry can do to help bolster them up and let them do their strongest performance. So it's a panel, it's gonna be on June 6th. Anybody can sign up. It's gonna be all over Zoom, so please, if you have the time and you wanna check it out, it's really cool. If you know anybody who's interested in that universe, implore them to check it out, but I'm really, really excited. It's a really cool crowd.
And the information's on your Instagram.
Yes, yeah. You can find it
so
on them.
You guys,
are you gonna tell one of my favorite jokes with that? Which is, you know, what is a dyslexic, agnostic insomniac do? Lies awake at night in bed wondering if there really is a dog.
I was ready like, oh wow, great joke. That's really funny, Josh. Like, that's
you'll tell me if
that's right. No, afterwards.
Am I just canceled?
You are canceled.
If you guys hear any loud noises coming from behind the curtain after the panel, don't worry about it. You'll be fine. We'll take care.
I'll come for you.
Thank you. Alright, yeah. We're going to have details.
You're not so, yeah, good, okay.
Yeah.
So, Chris, you want to do any audience questions? Oh, I knew you did.
How did we know?
I already knew where I was. This girl has been to every panel and she has the best questions or comments for that matter. Get ready. Oh.
Okay, so. I've never talked to you before, so I have a question for you. Margot, love you. My first time meeting you was the cornhole.
Yeah.
Love you.
You're great. Thank you.
I've told Josh this a couple of times, so I have to tell you this. You played the hell out of Sebastian because I hate him in the comics and in the show. Like, you did that.
I hated him
in the show. Especially in the show because he was a grown-ass man, and in the comics he was a child. So how do you feel about your comic book counterpart, and have you read the comics? Because I don't know if you've read them before.
I have indeed. Two-parter is one. I feel like, you know, when, as an actor, it's so lucky to join something where there's already lore to begin with. And as previously stated with not being able to read very well, I felt like it was kind of fate that the thing I would be involved is a comic book series. So that really worked out. But it was really exciting because I did honestly, like, look over those panels a ton of time and try to figure out, like, are the things here I want to take from, which parts do I obviously want to make my own, knowing that, you know, the show really weaves that narrative between being faithful to the comics, or we see things like, you know, Yumiko is taking over Michonne's line, things like that. So we know that they do take pieces and also obviously take big liberties, which I think is really cool. But I was really, really stoked to try to weave that in there. And obviously to show up to work and be an unmitigated prick to everybody and applaud you for it is a very rare and exciting opportunity, especially when you get to do it to Michael James Shaw, who I would never do that to.
And thankfully, never mind, I'm not going to say that people haven't read the comics. I'm just happy you didn't.
You didn't do what I
yeah,
did
yeah, in the comics. I didn't know that was going to happen, and I literally cried. I was so mad. I was like, oh, I'm so happy this is never going to happen in the show. I'm so happy.
No!
Of course I do! What are you kidding? No, the only thing is, like, I think you guys would have killed me if I did. No, it was so funny because, like, I would get messages the whole time being, like, you know, speculating to me who it's gonna happen. And the funny thing is, like, we as the actors, like, I'm getting the scripts as they're coming out. It's not like I'm ahead of the curve on this kind of thing or anything. So people are messaging me, like, I think it's this person. I'm like, damn, that's a good theory. You know, I'm kind of thinking that. And then somebody else messages with another one, like, ooh, I don't know, that's actually even better theory. So I was just along for the ride, like, literally everybody else on that one.
And also, the script can change at any time.
Oh,
right?
Actually, yeah.
I mean, we've heard stories of, like,
on the day
of filming, and you guys get handed a script, and, oh, we made these changes, and it's, like, major changes.
Yep.
And you're like, oh, okay, I'm just gonna, I'll figure it out, you know?
Yep.
So I died today. Thank you.
Yeah. Do you have any more questions?
I want to ask him something. So with this downtime with the writer's strike and everything going on, do you guys work on something personally, like, for the acting side, or you guys decide to venture into, like, other areas? I don't know, like, could be art or music or whatever. So are you guys, like, honing, putting your energy into, like, different things right now?
I feel like this is kind of, this feels, at least to me, like, what the pandemic felt like. You know, the world was shut down. Our industry obviously was shut down. I remember getting a call. I was working on an indie in Oklahoma, And we were the first production in the area to get shut down, but other productions were already starting to close. And we were actually across the street from the NBA player that touched all the mics and then gave the whole team COVID. So all through the night, I listened to ambulances going like across the street, across, and then everybody tried to come into our hotel and they locked that down. And it was just, it was a crazy, crazy time. So like during that time, I had a lot of friends that were super, super creative. People came up with unbelievable things. Like I had a girlfriend who made these videos, which were so beautiful, with all of her bandmates, and everybody filmed themselves from home. And y'all probably saw this too at some point, at somewhere. But like they were all up on the screen, and they all had like individual boxes, and they were playing to the one song. And then like you got like messages, they would send it to people in the hospital or whatever. And I just thought that was so cool and so creative. And I felt no creativity whatsoever during like a full 2 years. And I thought I was broken. And then I started talking to other friends, and they were like, yeah, nothing has moved creatively inside of me at all. But weirdly, during this strike, I felt more creative than ever, because I feel like we have to hustle more for other people now. And the earlier, you know, was more of we had to hustle for ourselves to help our own personal mental health. Yeah. Now it's just, yes, we need to also be cautious of our own personal mental time during this downtime so that we don't go too stir crazy. But we also need to be aware of what happens after this strike and how we change things moving forward. So I felt more creative than ever, but it's on like a full scale of things. But yeah, so I feel like I flipped. Everybody that was creative in 2020, now everybody's sitting on their ass. And I'm like, you know, like, and I'm like busting mine, and I was totally sitting on my hands like for 2 years. So that's just me though.
I mean, I think there's a fine line where you're trying to, kind of what Margot was saying, the like balance between the rest and knowing, especially with something like this, that there's just really no way to predict how long it's gonna last. I mean, the previous one lasted 100 days for the writers. They've had ones that have lasted 150 days. I don't think it will, but it could end tomorrow. And obviously now we're looming on the potential of writers striking, DGA striking. So it's really kind of the unknown. And so I think there's also, it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. And knowing like how to conserve that energy and where you want to put it into. So like, I've been meeting with a lot of friends, and like either we are reading a script together or working on even an old self-tape that somebody just wants to put up again. And I think it's hard, especially, I mean, you know, if you have that writing capability or something like that, that's amazing, because you can do that as a solo venture. Acting is so difficult, as it's very, you know, incumbent upon having other people around you and working with other people. It's a very extroverted, you know, thing versus the ability to work insularly. So there's a difficulty of trying to maintain that art, and as you're kind of getting into whether that means looking into other fields.
Also, it doesn't feel that different. I mean, you know, it's not like we're always working, you know, being out of work, not having a job doesn't feel that, it doesn't feel different. I mean, I haven't worked in months, and now I'm just still not working. So it doesn't, not like, oh no, I can't, you know, you're usually not working, so it doesn't feel like, what do I do with my time, you know? Yeah.
So my question's for all of you. I think it's kind of like bittersweet that, you know, we're seeing everyone here this weekend, people from season one to the last season, and characters that we really love, that we haven't seen like interact. So I'm curious if there were any like storylines from the past episodes or characters that you wish maybe you got to be a part of or interact with?
I mean, sure, so many, I mean, obviously so many, it's like there's very few I wouldn't have wanted to work with, you know, but I never met him obviously, but I would have loved to have, you know, met and worked with Scott Wilson. He seemed like he would have been a really special person to work with. And yeah, so that's.
I mean, even within the season, there's like, I mean, I thought there was something really fun about like working with Aaron, you know, that character, and like just seeing the interactions that they would have had. Even, I mean, you and I didn't really like have much of an interaction.
No,
obviously, I feel like there's a lot of stuff you were pulling strings on, yeah. But I feel like it would have been just fun to like see where that world goes.
Totally, yeah.
Yeah. We had too many interactions.
Right? Too many.
Yeah, those days were awful.
Oh God.
Yeah, we just would bring down the set with our negativity.
Is he still talking?
Jeez.
Anyways, I would have loved to have worked with Lori. She was just so badass. And especially, like, I don't know why the scene just keeps popping up in my head when they were in the, I think it was the first episode, right? Like, when they're in the super mall, and, like, it's that turn, that roundabout, like, clothing rack, when they're, like, boarding up the doors in the beginning, when they're stuck in the building, they go to the rooftop. My mom used to own a clothing store, like, as a kid, and I would hide in those clothing racks and, like, you know, talk to all of the imaginary friends in here, which is a terrifying thing, place up here. And there's just so many people up there. And so I would just sit in the center. So, like, when they were all in there with all the mannequins and, like, before the dogs started to attack them a little bit. But I just wanted to be in that scene so badly. Like, the fury of this thing happening that you just have no idea what's happening. And you have no other chance or choice but to just run and just try your best to survive. You don't even know what you're fighting. Like, that, the way that everybody in season one played that was just unbelievable. And I've never met her before, so I got to meet her this weekend, which was so cool. And she's so cool. I mean, she's so cool. So, yeah, that was cool.
Awesome. Thank you.
Any more questions?
Think we're good?
All right. Well,
thank you guys.
Thank you guys. Thank you. Yes. Thanks for joining us. One more time, give it up for Margot, Theo, and John.